Hey guys, in this video I'm gonna be showing you how this giant door that I recently invented works. So let's just replace this quartz with glass so you can see through. There we go. Now there are a ton of different circuits as you can see, so let's just start with the black one, should we? So this is the black circuit. As you can see, there is a wire there and one there, and they both come from this lever. So when the input turns on, a bunch of things triggers over there. So you can see that turns on, and when it turns off, a bunch of things trigger over there. Actually only one thing, but we can do that by having a monostable circuit here. This is a pretty long monostable circuit. It has 1.2 second delay over here. So when this lever turns on, that wire there turns on for about 1.2 seconds. And it triggers a bunch of stuff. First, it triggers this here. This is the 4-piston extender, so these pistons push the sand to the left and push the door out of the way. By the way, the red wool is just to hold the sand up. And then when this turns off after 1.2 seconds, the pistons retract. Then after a bit of delay, a circuit down here triggers the blue circuit. And what that does is it opens the these four blocks here so the sand can fall down, and then this also goes to another monostable circuit which makes the pulse even shorter. I'm not even sure if I need that, but after a long delay, this starts a big system that brings the sand back up. And when the lever turns off, this is much simpler. A shorter monostable circuit here triggers, and it just triggers these pistons for 0.8 seconds, so they push the door back in place. These don't even need to be sticky pistons. I'm not sure why I use sticky pistons, but I'm too lazy to fix it now. So let's go on to the 4-piston extender, which is the white circuit. Now the white circuit is the only one I have actually copied from somewhere, and namely it is a part of an infinitely expandable piston extender design by Codecrafted. So you can see that at this link over there. But remember that that design in particular is broken in the snapshots that I'm using, the 1.5 snapshots, because they slightly changed the way butt switches work. So he used butt switches to control the pistons with these wires, but I don't have a horizontal piston extender anyway. I have a vertical one, so I had to came up with another way of wiring these wires to the pistons, each wire to the to one column of pistons separately. So I've done that by inventing the yellow circuit over here, which I kinda derped at painting, because you can see there's tons of white parts in it. But that doesn't really matter. The way we separate the signal to each column separately is by repeaters pointing into pistons. So for example, this repeater powers this piston and this piston. It doesn't go to the left or right as it would with redstone lamps. And this is really neat, because this way we can use repeaters to power the columns separately, and then to connect repeaters together we just use a half slab staircase with redstone. And that is the only reason why this door can only be 16 blocks high. It could be higher if I used a different method, but that's enough for me. And every other column we have to extend the repeaters to here and have the staircase over here, otherwise the staircases would be right next to each other and they wouldn't quite work because they would connect. So that's connected to the outputs of the 4 piston extender, and we can just flick the lever and see it in action. So that's how they retract. That's what the piston extender back there does. And now we will explain the blue circuit, which is to open these 4 blocks so the sand can fall down. There we go. Here you have your classic one block remover or one block door, stacked 4 times next to each other. And this is the wire that powers these pistons. These are the repeaters that power these pistons after a little delay. And the power comes from this torch. There's a pulse extender here, so when power comes here, this RS nor ledge here, that's so hard to say. Anyway, it switches the states, and this is then powered, and this turns off, so the door opens. And then after this delay here, the RS nor ledge switches back, and this turns back on, and the door closes. So let me show it to you. So right after the sand is pushed, this activates, as I've explained before, and you could see this door or whatever closed right after all the sand fell down. So as soon as the sand falls down, there is ground here so you can walk, and that's kind of luxury. Anyway, the next thing we are going to explain is the system that brings the sand back up, because you could see it fell down in the void now, and we don't want that. And this system is extremely complicated, so I split it up in a ton of parts, and the first of them is this cyan part, which is basically just a pulse extender. The same thing we had down there at the blue part, but as you can see, there is no that long delay that we had before. The delay is the green circuit right here. So as you can see, it is an extremely long delay. It starts here, goes down here, goes here and around. And as it does everything here, it goes down one level, and there's a bunch of delay here, and then it goes even lower. I'm not gonna explain this in great detail because I don't really think it is useful to anyone. But what I do want to show you is that this is a special kind of a pulse extender. So the pulse came here, and the pulse extender started. You can see the delay starts turning on, and there is no pulse that goes through a delay, it's just an on signal. Because, as I said, this is a special kind of a pulse extender that first it turns all the delay on, and when that's finished, it doesn't turn off this output pulse just yet. Before that, it also turns the delay off. As you can see, the delay is here, and it's almost finished. And now, see, the pulse doesn't stop, it starts turning off also. So that basically doubles your delay, and you can see more about these advanced pulse extenders on this link, which happens to be a video also by CodeCrafted. That's just a coincidence, but I think that is a really useful thing to have double the delay, because as you can see, now it turned off. That makes your devices way smaller. And I know there are many ways to make a delay. This is not the only concept. This is actually the most, the worst concept space-wise. It would be way smaller if I used, let's say, item hoppers, but that's just the way I did it. And right now this pulse extender doesn't do anything, so let's add the lime circuit. So if you watched my showcase video for this door, which if you haven't, the link is right there. So if you watched it, you've seen that only 4 sand get transported at a time, and then it waits a couple of seconds. And there is a very good reason for that that I will explain later, but the circuit that does break the sand transportation is this lime circuit. It's basically a clock that triggers sand transportation for enough time that 4 sand can get transported, and then it breaks it for a couple of seconds. And it's basically just a clock. These repeaters are powered from this torch right now, and when the pulse extender starts, this piston and this torch are going to activate at pretty much the exact same time. So the repeaters are going to start kind of moving around here. The same amount of repeaters is going to be powered all the time, but they'll just start moving around, and that's a really nice way to set up a clock in Minecraft, and you should remember that. It's something very useful. Now if I trigger this, we have to wait for the pulse to come here, and the pulse extender starts. Now you can see this repeaters moving around, and you can see the same setup here. This is to trigger another clock that is a part of the orange circuit. So let's add it in right now. Here it is, and this is the clock I was talking about. As you can see, only one repeater set on one tick is powered right now, so when the clock starts, a single repeater on one tick will start moving around. So it's basically a one tick clock. It gives one tick pulses out, and these pulses go to different pistons here, and then some more down here, and some more down here. This is the most complicated part, and it was probably the most complicated one to build, because I needed to get all these timings optimal, so they are as fast as they can be with the sand transportation to still work perfectly. And by the way, the torches are just so repeaters don't update the lighting, because they are in the shadow down here, so it just prevents lag a little bit. And then down here we have a bunch more pistons, and the sand is supposed to come from here, but this part we haven't added just yet. So let's just get ourselves some sand. And so this is how the sand comes in. It comes here and down, and then this piston pushes it up, up to here, and then this piston grabs the sand, and this piston pushes it even further up, it comes all the way up to these pistons. Same thing happens here, and it goes up to this, and this piston just pushes the sand into the pit, and it slowly fills up. Now we need these pistons here, and this is really important. These pistons extend whenever the pulse extender is working, because we need sand here if we want to fill the pit up. If we didn't have this sand here, it would put itself here anyway. You know what I mean? This piston would push the sand like this, and then it would start falling down. But after the sand has been transported, we don't want any sand up here, because when the piston extender extends, this sand would fall in the gaps between the pistons, and that is a really, really bad thing. So that's why I have these pistons. And now we can't really trigger it, because it's not gonna be doing anything. We can do this, and the sand will just fill itself in as it is needed. That's also what I did when I was testing the timings, and I usually just used MC Edit to fill this sand up. So that should be about enough. Let's trigger it. So this started working. You can see this clock turns on and off as it should, and when it turns on, it transports 4 sand. 1, 2, 3, 4. And that's one column. This sand is on here because it fell down from the beginning when these pistons extended. And this is probably gonna take a while. And I skipped that, because I thought it is boring. Now the pulse extender will finish. So all the clocks stop, and this retracts also, as it should, because we don't want sand here. Now let's build the circuit that actually brings the sand here, because we don't want to get it from a stack over here. Our goal is to get it from this giant pile that falls down. So let's add that. Now obviously, if we want to get this one row of the sand pile into this transportation, we will need a 4 piston extender, another one. And the problem with the 4 piston extender, which is not here just yet, the problem is that when it gets one pulse, it pushes 4 sand, and when this stuff gets one pulse, it only pushes 1 sand. So as this gets 4 pulses, we only want the pulse extender, the piston extender, to get a single pulse. And that's what the light blue circuit is all about. When the first pulse comes in here, it goes to this piston right away, and as you guys know, when a sticky piston gets a 1-tick pulse, it leaves its block like here, and then this wire is cut, so the rest of the pulses cannot come in here, and we only have one pulse. Then to get this block back, we have this delay, and after this delay, the piston extends again. Not for 1 tick, but that doesn't matter anymore. And it pulls the block back. So now we have only one pulse here, and that triggers these pistons first, and then we have a tiny pulse extender here, and then it goes to the 4-piston extender. So let's add that. And we have pretty much the same deal as we had above there. The only difference is that these pistons have a limit how fast they can push the sand, and that is 5 ticks. So that's why I have the 5 tick clock up there. And that is actually so fast that the sand doesn't have time to fall down, so we need this piston to push it down right here. But the problem that comes with that, you can see at this pulse extender that these here are the repeaters that make the pistons extend, and as you can see there is a 2-tick difference, so it waits 2 ticks and then it extends the next piston. But with this pulse extender down here, piston extender I mean, I keep saying pulse extender, pardon me. Anyway, with this we need pistons to wait 5 ticks before the next one extends, and 5 ticks is just too much for a single repeater, so we need all this gray stuff. I made it as compact as possible, but it is kinda bulky still, and that basically makes the same effect as if we had 5 tick repeaters in here. And let me put all the sand in that we need, and I can actually show it to you. So let's switch today, and yeah, we can see the sand lands right here. And now when this starts, let's actually have a look at these. If you look at this wire carefully, you can see there are 1, 2, 3, 4 pulses, and over here there is only one pulse, one. And this is what extends these pistons. And as you can see, the delays are just perfect. The moment these pistons retract, new sand comes in, and then they start extending right away. They don't wait or anything. And that's what I was talking about. That's what was really hard to do with all these delays here. I had to get all that perfect. And the door is almost reset. You'll be able to see these pistons pull back the sand as it finishes, and that's important as I explained earlier. There we go. And now we just need to close the door yet. It doesn't work because we need another yellow circuit right here. And this guy is so simple that I don't think I need to explain anything at all. You can see everything from just looking at it. And oh, well, we need to open it again if we want to see it closing. That was just a visual glitch, don't worry. So it closes like that, and the pistons stay here. But that is not so, that is not a problem, because when this piston extend, when these pistons extend, they will push the door here anyway, so they will all correct themselves. And yeah, that's basically it. I didn't make this video to make it possible for you to build this door in survival. That was not my intention, because it's just too expensive for survival. I just wanted to explain you these circuits that I used to make the door work, and I hope you'll be able to use these circuits in your own creations. So hopefully you find this useful, and thanks for watching. By the way, don't forget to drop a like or a comment on this video, because it took me ages to make the video, not just because of all the montages, but also because I have trouble speaking English, so I had to record every clip like 10 times before I got it right. So definitely don't forget to show some support, it's just one click away, and yeah, that's it, I'll see you at the next video.